Hey everybody, it's Lon.TV, and we're taking a look today at the Shuttle XPC Nano. It's a little mini PC powered by a Broadwell Celeron processor. I do want to mention, in the interest of full disclosure, this came in on loan from Shuttle. We'll be giving it back to them when we're done with this review. All the opinions you're about to hear are my own. Nobody is paying for this review, and no one is reviewing this content before it is posted. So let's get into the hardware here. There's a couple of different ways to buy this one. So this is a $285 version. It has a Windows 10 license, 2 gigabytes of RAM, and 32 gigabytes of internal SSD storage. Not eMMC, it's an actual SSD. I took it apart, I checked. There's also a stripped down bare bones version with no Windows operating system and no RAM, but they do give you 16 gigabytes of storage. That one's $173. And then there's an i3 version with 2 gigs of RAM, 32 gigabytes of storage, and Windows 10 for $343. All of these are based on the Broadwell architecture, which is the last year's generation of Intel chips. So we're now on the 6th generation, this is 5th generation, but the processor architecture is the same family of chips as the i3, i5, and i7 processors from last year. So this is going to be a lot faster than some of the Atom and Braswell fanless computers we have looked at in the past. This one does have a fan, but it will run faster, and in some areas a lot faster than those other chips are, because it's more of a desktop-oriented architecture. So a little bit quicker, very similar to what we saw on the MSI QB, actually the same chip on the MSI QB, as well as an Acer Chromebox we looked at not too long ago either. So it should be pretty quick when we get through all of that. So now that you know what's inside, here's what's outside. We've got a memory card slot here for SD cards, so you can stick your camera card in there. You've got two USB 3.0 ports on the front. This I thought was interesting, and in case you don't know what this is a serial port. There hasn't been one of these on a mini computer in a long time, at least ones that I have been testing. But if you have, you know, an old dial-up modem or some other kind of specialty device, this is a RS-232 or DB9 serial adapter there. You can just plug in your serial devices and have at it. You have two USB 2.0 ports on the back. Gigabit Ethernet is over here. HDMI out. It will go to 4K, although I didn't get it out of this port, so I think you need to put your 4K stuff on the DisplayPort adapter over there. And you have power. There's also an audio output over here. And that is pretty much it. It does have a fan built in, and it is a little bit noisy. It doesn't come on all the time, but once the processor gets under a little bit of load, you're going to hear it. And I had set it up in my little home theater nook over there a little while ago, and I was definitely hearing it across the room. So it does have a bit of a whine to it, a little bit more than I've seen with other mini PCs in this form factor. So if you are sensitive to fan noise, it's definitely going to make some noise for you. But let's boot it up, we'll see how it operates, and then we'll take it apart. All right, so let's take a look at some web browsing first, and we'll go over to my YouTube channel and see how fast everything renders up on screen here. So as you can see, it comes up very quickly, and you've got yourself my YouTube channel, a video here streaming up right away at 1080p. This is, of course, is scaled down to this little window here, but if we go into our stats for nerds, we're not seeing any drop frames or anything like that. I should mention I'm on Ethernet, but there's also wireless AC built in, so it supports 5 gigahertz networks, and it also has Bluetooth built in too, so you can connect your Bluetooth devices to it. It does okay with 1080p 60 video on YouTube, so I'll close that out and load up my 1080p 60 video here from one of my drone videos from a while back. This runs fine at 1080p at 60 frames per second. But what I did find is that it didn't like the YouTube 4K video when I tried to get that going. And that might be an issue if you are on a 4K television, because this is what I'm seeing here when I load up these 4K videos. And it's rather odd that we're getting this problem here, because generally this works on most of the mini PCs that we test, even ones I think running with this processor. But I've been having some issues with this, getting this working, and the video's been all messed up, getting a lot of drop frames and everything else like that too. So probably not going to say a 4K video watching device here. It does do okay with files that it's playing locally, as you'll see later in the video here, but I did struggle a bit with 4K video from YouTube and over on web browsers. So you definitely want to keep that in mind as you're poking around here. But general web browsing is pretty fast on here. And again, it'll be a little bit quicker than a lot of the other mini PCs out there, primarily because you're dealing with a desktop class processor here. So you can see how fast a typical website loads up on it. And on the Octane benchmark test that we run in Google Chrome, we get a score of 12,908, which puts it pretty much in line with the MSI QB, which was also running Windows with the same processor. But take a look at the Acer Chromebox and the Acer C740. Both of those run Chrome OS, and as you can see here, those two devices do better, primarily because Chrome OS is much more optimized just to have the web browser. There's less overhead on those machines. And if you want to get some work done, it's great for doing word processing and everything else that you might see. This is our usual newsletter template that we pull up just because it has a lot of text and graphics in it. And as you can see here, as we move images around and readjust things, it does respond very quickly, and it is responding faster than we saw on some of those other fanless devices. All right, so let's take a look now at some gaming on the device here. We've got Minecraft loaded up, and we're running with the Optifine Performance Enhancing plugin. You can see the frame rate in the upper left-hand corner. We're getting frame rates around 30 to 40 frames per second, but it doesn't feel all that smooth to me. It's a little bit jumpy as we're walking through the world here. And I have a theory on this, which I think will be proven out when we take it apart, in that this is dual channel RAM, but there's only one stick of RAM in the computer right now. So these GPUs on board these little computers tend to do better when you have both the RAM slots occupied. They can get their data a little bit faster. And I think that's what we're seeing here, is just not having both of those slots occupied is giving us a bit of a performance hit. So I think you might see better gaming performance if you do put two sticks of RAM in versus the one that it comes with. Let's take a look now at Counter-Strike Go and see how it does with that. All right, here we are with Counter-Strike Go. You can see what my settings are here. We'll pop out of here and then start playing the game a little bit. We're not getting great frame rates. We turned down the settings, as you saw, to get somewhat of a smooth frame rate at 1920 by 1080, but we're only getting about 20 frames per second or thereabouts. So this is definitely not going to be a game-playing machine. Most of these little mini computers aren't, at least for games like this. You will get a performance boost of to some degree if you do occupy both of those RAM slots, but by and large, this is what you're going to see for general performance at 1080. But I think if you occupy both of those RAM slots, turn your settings way down, 720p on a game like this might work, but I wouldn't consider this a platform for AAA titles or anything else like that. And on the 3D Mark CloudGate test, which tries to put a number to its gaming performance, we get a score of 2,267, which isn't much better than two Pentium-based devices we've looked at recently, which are lower-powered chips. But you will see that the Nano does better in the graphics department, not so well in the physics department. And the reason for that is twofold. One is that I don't think we have the full performance here maxed out because both RAM chips are not occupied. But we also have a dual-core processor on this one compared to a quad-core processor on those Pentium devices. So although this chip is faster, it doesn't have the ability to do as much at one time as those other devices do, which are quad-core based computers. But let's take a look now at some things it is good at, which is home theater playback. Let's have a look at that running Kodi, and then we'll take it apart. All right, so we got Kodi loaded up here. We're going to start with this Big Buck Bunny HEVC file, which is a high efficiency codec that a lot of folks are interested in. This is a 4K file that's playing at 1080, but you can see how slowly this 10 second video clip plays back. It's taking it almost twice as long, if not a little bit longer, to get this playback. This is a real stress test here, because it's got a lot of motion going on with all those blades of grass turning there, but it's a good way to tell whether or not a computer can play back 4K video in some of these newer formats quite well, and it really doesn't here. So I don't think this is going to be a good 4K playback mechanism. As you saw with that YouTube video, we also had trouble with 4K streaming over from YouTube, so that isn't so good. But what does work well is 1080p stuff. So I've got a movie running here. This is a 1080p Blu-ray MKV file, so the full bitrate Blu-ray. This is running very well off of my solid-state drive here. I tested it over the network earlier. I was able to stream the movie via my home network very easily also. So I don't think you're going to have any issues with 1080p content, just the 4K stuff. One thing it does do, though, is it works with the higher-end audio format. So I was able to get DTS-HD audio over to my home theater receiver from this, which is something that a lot of these mini computers don't do. So that was good to see. But again, I was hearing the fan a little bit when I was in my home theater nook earlier. So now the moment you've all been waiting for, we're going to take this thing apart. Let's see what's inside. So it's not too hard to get at the guts of this computer. We're going to flip it over real quick. Now, what I did before I started shooting the video today was take out these two rubber feet here. There are four rubber feet total. I took those two off. I didn't need to. So it's just these two on the bottom here. This, by the way, is an expansion port of some kind. I believe they'll probably have some stackable modules. I've seen this now on a few other mini PCs where you can buy these little modules and stack them underneath the computer to add some storage and other capabilities. So we'll see if they come up with anything for that. So once you get those two screws out, all you have to do now is just put a tool of some sort or another into that little slot right there, and then you can get at the bottom of the case. Now, most of the stuff that you may want to get at is on the other side of the motherboard, and you have to unscrew it to get there. But on this side, you have an additional RAM slot here, which is unoccupied, as we mentioned. So you have that and the Bluetooth and Wi-Fi module here. But you do have to, again, have to take the motherboard off to get at the bottom of it. And you can see a photo of what it looks like on the other side of the board there. You can't change out the processor, but you can get at the other stick of RAM that's in here and swap out its M2 SATA SSD drive. So you can put in a larger drive and add more memory to it, but you can't swap out the processor. So if you want that i3 processor, you're going to have to buy it that way to get into it. But it's not too hard to get at, just a few screws to get that motherboard lifted out. You do want to be careful though, because the antennas here for the wireless radio are soldered into this board here. And if you're too quick with your movements, you might pull them out and have to re-solder everything. So definitely be careful with that when you're pulling it out. But that's really the only caution that I would have beyond doing the usual static grounding and that sort of thing. So that is the Shuttle XPC Mini PC, and it performs about where you would expect a Broadwell Celeron-based device to perform. It is hampered a bit, though, in its configuration that I got here by the fact that it only has one of those RAM slots occupied. So my advice would be, if you were to buy this, get two sticks of 4 gigs of RAM, bring it up to 8 gigabytes, put a little bit more storage in here, and I think it's going to perform a lot better with both of those channels of RAM occupied, especially for trying to play some games on it. I was not pleased with its 4K video performance though, so I'm not going to recommend this as a 4K video playback device. It does do well at 1080p as you saw, and it supports some of the higher end home theater video formats too, which was great to see. But the fan noise might be enough to deter some home theater enthusiasts from getting one. You'll often want a very quiet home theater. You're definitely going to hear the fan on this one. So that is the Shuttle XPC Nano, and this is Lon Seibin. Thanks for watching. This channel is brought to you by my Patreon supporters. If you want to help the channel, you can by contributing as little as $1 a month. Head over to Lon.TV/Patreon to learn more. And don't forget to subscribe. Visit Lon.TV/S.